You're listening to Fishing the DMV with your hosts, Thomas Ahrens and Jared Mounts. Fishing the DMV is brought to you by Jake's Bait and Tackle, located in Winchester, Virginia.
If that doesn't get you jacked up, I don't know what will.
All right, so how are we doing this morning? I know it's been a long time since we've actually gotten to do one of these live streams. It's been a crazy couple of weeks for me. I think you guys know that follow my Instagram and stuff. I graduated from my MBA program, getting this going, trying to fish tournaments. Had a lot of podcast episodes that we've been recording. It's been pretty remarkable how well you guys have taken to this thing, and I really, really appreciate it. I really want to do the Hidden Gem series. I know you guys really, really want me to bring that back. It just takes a lot more shooting and editing to get the Hidden Gem series up, and I really don't want to just pump a bunch of them out. I really want quality content with a good script that really tells the story of the places that we go. So I'm hoping to start back up the Hidden Gem series. I'm going to shoot in June, and then we're going to hopefully have that come out in July. It's kind of what I'm thinking, is once per month to make sure the quality is good there. So yeah, today's schedule, we're going to just give a little rundown about what's going on here, what I did. And then we got a really, really awesome guest that we were able to get in. We got Greg Nosar, who finished second at the second stop of the kayak tournament trail. He had 74 inches and 74.75 inches. It was a tough tournament. And I guess that kind of leads into my spiel, because we'd rather get mine done first and then talk to the big gun, because this was my first kayak tournament I ever did. First time ever doing something like this. This is coming from college tournaments, big boats, fished a couple of semi-pro circuits, and then going to this thing. And it was so much fun, and it was completely different. And I had my thoughts going into this thing compared to like when I got there, it completely changed. There's some strategy involved with this thing. I was looking at a map, and I really had some spots way in the back, up one of the creek arms at Lake Anna. So I said, like, all right, we're going to launch out of the cove at Lake Anna, and we're gonna see how we can get back there. What you don't realize is, you know, the engine, because I don't have a trolling motor. I have a pedal drive kayak. And spoiler, I should have known this. You need to get your cardio in and prep for this. Had too much coffee, and I was just trying, as soon as I launched the boat, I was gonna haul ass and blast. And I was like Lance Armstrong pedaling my little ass off. And then I kind of figured out 30 minutes into that I can't actually physically pedal my ass all the way back out there to the back and then pedal back and stay in one piece, because my legs started cramping. That's going to come into the story a little bit later. So I ditched that plan, start pedaling back into like the surrounding area. And then my hamstring and my groin had the worst cramp ever imaginable. And I ended up being butterflied out on this stupid thing, just stretching every 20, 30 minutes, getting my legs back before I could even fish. But I was able to figure a few things out. I didn't really, I didn't finish as well as I'd like to. I think I had like 27 inches. I think I finished 31st. I really started to get dialed in on how to fish out of a kayak, how do you approach spots and everything, about around 11 o'clock. And then I got on a little bluegill bed deal, and I was able to stick a couple. I lost a really nice one too. And this is, again, something about fishing that kayak. I was throwing a square bill, and they set the hook on him, and it didn't occur to me when I set the hook that I should backpedal the kayak to keep tension in the line. It was something else. Like if you're in a boat and you set on a crankbait, what I do is I just start backing up. I walk. I didn't do that. I just got lost in the moment. And as soon as I saw him go to the surface, I was like, yep, he's coming off. And yeah, he did. But it was a good learning experience. Like the idea of like getting the net. Okay. Like I need to position the net in a different spot. How you approach different docks. Well, it's a little bit different, a kayak versus a boat. And so it was really interesting, and I really enjoyed it. I want to strategize a little bit more about like picking apart your areas. And this is the thing I told my wife and my friends afterwards. This will make me a better fisherman completely. I have a tendency when I think in a boat, and I'm going to ask Greg this too, when we get Brian on the show, when you have a boat, you feel like you can just fish the whole lake. And so your strategy is, if there's no fish there, just go somewhere else, just leave. And that was the way I approached the tournament when I first started. Was like, I'm just going to keep pedaling, I'll eventually find them. When I settled down, I was like, nope, this is my area, this is my pond, and I'm just going to fish it. That's when the pieces started clicking. And I was like, driving home from the event, I was like, yeah, this is going to make me a better angler, because I can't try to fish all of Lake Anna in a kayak, or at least that's my theory. You need to pick an area and grind. And I started to learn an area that I didn't think was anything special, honestly, and that there are fish there. And this was something that when we talked to Nolan Miner, actually, we had him on the podcast. He said, that's the thing about kayak fishing is it teaches you to fish and catch what's in front of you. And I really think I'm going to take that with me, not only to the next kayak tournament, but also the next, you know, boat tournament I fish. That was like my tournament, nothing special, with the channel. Congrats to us. We had over 1400 views and over, I think, 150 hours of watch time on Creek Fishing Adventures. You guys love it when I bring the YouTubers on, and I'm going to try to keep doing that. And the point of interviewing those guys is I really think the industry doesn't give them a lot of props. I talk to a lot of, I want to say semi-professional anglers, and I'm not going to name names, but they turn their nose up at a lot of YouTubers for some reason. And it's weird because you look at a person like Fishhawk or Creek Fishing Adventure, very polished in front of a camera, very professional, and they move product. They do. They're ambassadors to the industry. And yet I feel like a lot of people don't look at them like, hey, they're making a living doing what they love. It's not tournament fishing like it used to be, but they're still getting people involved in the sport and they're helping companies grow. So we'll hopefully continue to mix a blend of what we generally do, plus bringing on some interesting YouTubers to learn their story as well. But you guys are probably done listening to me just blabber, right? So why don't we bring on our guest here? So without further ado, the man, the myth, and the legend, Greg, how are you doing this morning,
sir? Ned, good morning, Thomas. How are you doing, man?
I can't complain at all.
Good.
So, yeah, really to get started, through a little back and forth, I didn't know
you. First of all, hold on, I'm going to say this. Congratulations on your MBA, all that stuff, the education, man, great, bright future. And, you know, I graduated with a business degree and didn't go for my MBA. That's a huge accomplishment, man. So, good stuff.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. I didn't realize that you're famous. I didn't know you had a TV show. I was trying to call you last night to be like, does he need prep or anything else? And then the guy that we were buddies with on that message, like, dude, do you know like what he does for a living? Like, I had no idea. So I researched like, oh shit, man, he could give me some lessons on what to do.
No, you're doing a great job, man. No, you keep on doing you, man. So it's all good.
So yeah, I guess give a backdrop. Like, how did you get into kayak fishing? How did you get into your digital media career? That's such a weird blend that there's so many people that are doing both in the fishing industry now.
Honestly, look, I love content creation. It's something I've always been, you know, I just love it. You know what I mean? I just have a passion for it. So, I mean, I've been kayak fishing since 2012, been a fisherman since I was a kid. Mm-hmm. You know, just grew up around here, you know, Northern Virginia, fishing, actually walking the Bull Run Creek and, fishing the Potomac River and, you know, just going pond hopping all over the place, everywhere I could get my hands on fish. Really started kayak fishing, I mean, pretty heavily, more saltwater stuff in 2012. Wow. Fishing a lot of saltwater tournaments offshore, going out, you know, 5 miles or 8 miles out in the Chesapeake Bay with a Hobie, you know, going out in the middle of the shipping channels and people are like, you're freaking crazy, you know? Some of the things I look back at stuff I was doing, I mean, I just didn't know any better. I mean, honestly, should have been out there, but, you know, just have a huge passion for fishing and, you know, started getting into the bass tournament scene, locally, started here with NVKBA. By the way, I think it's the best local bass trail ever. I mean, Mike Ortega just does an awesome job.
And huge shout out to them for everything they put on their events. Fantastic.
Yeah. I mean, you know, and the people of NVKBA, the fishermen, I travel all over the country and fish, man. They're just first class and, you know, very happy to be a part of this local trail. And, you know, again, going with the KBFs, the Hobies and the Basses of the world, had an opportunity 2 years ago during COVID go basically travel the country, took my dog and my camper, and I traveled and fished with some of the best fishermen in the country, and learned a lot, and then got to fish some of the best, fishing, areas, you know, lakes and everything else across this country. So I learned a lot, man. My fishing has dramatically improved because I've learned so much from these anglers, different techniques, and you kind of just hone it into your own self and kind of know what to look for and stuff. But I tell you, man, you know, it's so much fun. I mean, you know, I work, you know, I'm a mortgage banker. I'm always on the phone. I do more business on the water than I do in my office. You know what I mean? But you know, I'm fortunate, you know, I'm able to kind of, you know, telecommute and all that stuff. And
that's nice.
Yeah, it is. And yeah, in terms of the content creation, it's just, again, kind of mixing your passion with your, you know, it's not working, you know, like creating content's not working. You know, I get to work with some amazing people, some great friends of mine, and we kind of all do it together. And yeah, here we are, man. I have a network called Motion Sports Network. We started last December, which is pure sports, you know, covering, you know, every major sporting event. We've had some pretty heavy hitters in the DC area come on and talk sports. We just had George Mason's basketball coach, Kim wow. English, on this week. So, I mean, you know, we're just, you know, we're just trying to make a dent, man. Have a good time, incorporate some outdoors into our sports network. We have the thing, KFL, Kayak Fishing League, is kicking off June 4th. So in a week, basically, we've got to get ready to get prepared for that. So, yeah, I mean, it's busy. It's busy time, man. I just can't get enough of it, man. It's awesome.
No, it's crazy. And I really want you to touch on that. It seems like there's more and more independent either media coming out. Is that just because with the technology we have now and with the way, not to get political, but with how establishment covers it, is it giving an opportunity for people out there that say like, oh, I want to cover basket weaving? It's like, well, this is the opportunity to do that because you can have your voice out there and people are attracted to it.
So, you know, it's interesting you say that. Let me just kind of talk about the media overall, right? There's a huge shift in media, right? So if you take the stars back in the 80s and 90s, their goal was to get through school, get a communications degree, and mm-hmm. go to the big networks, right? You know, Fox, ABC, NBC, stuff like that. And, you know, if you become an anchor or, you know, if you're on the radio, you know, on those networks, then you've done something, right? There was a shift, and I don't think that people really understood, and I'm not a fan of his, but Howard Stern really, really kind of jump-started all this. Howard Stern was on, you know, regular radio, you know, when all of a sudden, you know, he was on WJFK and all the morning shows in New York and, you know, all this other stuff. And then he left. He started his own empire, you know, and started with Spotify. Started with XM Sirius satellite radio. Okay. And he was paid over a 5-year deal, $100 million or a year, you know, to come over there and do this. And that kind of like jump-started independent, free thinking, non-corporate freelancers to mm-hmm. do their own thing, right? So then you have the Joe Rogans of the world. They're doing their own podcast. They're selling their podcasts. You know, he's making close to $100 million a year doing that. And then you started seeing like the Barstools of the world and, you know, and it just started, you know, people started figuring out you don't have to have a big name behind you. You don't have to have Fox News. You don't have to have, you know, all these again networks going behind you. Mm-hmm. For instance, I mean, Conan O'Brien just signed a $150 million deal, you know, for Sirius XM to basically broadcast all of his podcasts. You've got Pat McAfee's of the world doing the same thing. He just signed a $120 million deal with FanDuel. So you're starting to see independent content creators not, you know, working for these, you know, big name networks or Disney or anything like that. They could do it themselves. Mm-hmm. And that has really spawned. I think it's just tremendous because here's the deal. It allows originality. You're not filtered. You're not governed. You can control your own content. And, you know, people love original content. I mean, that's what is really driving the internet. That's why the YouTubers do well, like Mr. Beast and all that stuff. I mean, these guys are original content. They don't work for the man. They work mm-hmm. for themselves. And, you know, with this newer generation, content creation and original content creation with talent and, you know, marketing and all that stuff is just an awesome dynamic. And, you know, I mean, you just got to be you, man. You can't create your, you know, your content based on what other people are doing. You got to do your own original stuff. And it just takes off, you know, if you work hard at it.
Yeah, and it's weird because, and I kind of alluded this to the intro, but like how corporate looks at YouTubers, and maybe I'm just thinking like specifically the fishing world. When I had a Creek Fishing Adventure on, he talked like it's hard to get companies to look at you seriously because you're like a YouTuber. But on the same token, if I talk about a rod and reel, they'll sell out immediately. So it's so weird, like this old guard, and it's like this is the disruptive technology, like, you know,
yeah.
The radio was replaced by the TV, and now we're having, I think, YouTube replacing the main media stem. And so yes. I don't know how long it's going to take, but eventually, I mean, corporate's got to get behind this more, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, I think corporate's already there. See, the thing is, I mean, you know, corporations know that, you know, obviously social media is a major part of what they do. Corporate, like, you know, major corporations are not just looking at, you know, the 100,000 stuff. They're looking at, you know, guys that have 5 million followers or more, you know, that's hard in the fishing world, you know, That's hard. So, you know, when they're trying to sell something, you know, I'll give you an example. Okay. Corporations are falling away from individual angler sponsorships, and they're basically promoting their own sponsor or their own product through their own median, right? So Bass Pro Shops, right? Jimmy Morris has, for years, you know, they bought out Ranger Boats. For years, they've all done their local marketing through the anglers, right? You know, they've sponsored all these different pros. Well, last year they came out and said that they're going to get rid of all their pro sponsorships. They don't want Ranger Boats is not sponsoring any kind of professional bass fishing in terms of individual bass fishermen. And a lot of bass fishermen walked away from their contracts. They went over to Skeeter. They went all these other boat companies because, you know, they were able to sign these deals with these other boat companies than Ranger. You think people are not buying Ranger Boats now because they're not signed with their favorite Bass Pro? No way, man. They're under the Bass Pro name. They're selling more boats now than they've ever sold before. Yeah. They didn't have to put all that money into professional bass sponsorships because, again, the name of Bass Pro, the median behind that, their own social media network, they don't have to sponsor, you know, individual anglers. And it's tough, man. I mean, if you're out there trying to create content for sponsorship, boy, that's a tough task. You know what I mean? That's like, that's why what we do, we try to do non-endemic sponsors. You know, we don't try to do endemic. We try to do non-endemic. We try to bring, we have a sponsorship through Rip It Energy, right? With the Rip It Energy drink with the KFL. That's a non-endemic sponsorship. Man, they love what we do. You know, it's something that's unique, different. You know, we're getting the word out. We're, you know, our anglers are promoting the product, but it's a very niche median, you know? Mm-hmm. So we want to bring in people that really don't understand the whole outdoors industry and connect their not understanding, but a great audience that we have with a different product that maybe our outdoorsmen have never used before. That's a perfect relationship.
How did you go from banking to media mogul? Like, that's a story in of itself. Well,
okay. Media mogul's a, you know, we're nowhere near that. I mean, I am in banking still, but again, man, my job, I've been doing it for over 20 years, man. It's like, you know, wash, rinse, repeat. I mean, it's just the same thing over and over and over again. You know, every day's different, but you know, it's the same type of deal. Again, I just love content creation, man. It's always something I've been doing. I've been on YouTube, I don't know, since 2009 when it first started, you know, my personal stuff, you know, but I mean, I haven't really built it up or anything like that, but, you know, I mean, we do have quite a bit of touches on a lot of different platforms. And maybe it's a little bit too many platforms, but, you know, we've developed our own app. We've developed our own, you know, broadcast network. You know, we're on Roku, Amazon. You know, that was a pain in the butt trying to get on, but we got on there. Yeah. So, I mean, we could broadcast all of our games live on those medium platforms, you know, YouTube and all that stuff. So, yeah, I mean, we're nowhere near anybody. I mean, trust me, we're dropping the pan compared to most of these people, but we are growing it, you know, and I think good quality content creation and diverse content creation is the key to that success.
Yes. Yes. I mean, we could talk about this. This is kind of what my major study was in my MBA program. This is the problem with Netflix, is they're just a jack of all trades, master of none. And it's like, if you're not good at anything, why would people want to pay to have your membership? And that's one reason I think they're dropping off like they are, is they don't have that niche stuff.
Yeah.
But guys, I know for everyone that's listening, you don't want to hear about this stuff. I could talk about this stuff for hours, but I guess we'll get into the fishing stuff. And the one thing before we get in the tournament is, so you said you spent a year just gypsying around the country fishing. Mm-hmm. How did the family agree on that, or what? I want to hear that real quick.
Look, you know, when COVID happened, the girls, you know, my girls were in high school, they could do virtual learning, right?
Oh,
so
cool.
Yeah, so we were able to bring, you know, I left for about 4 months. I went to Michigan and then down to Iowa, Texas, and then came back and met him in Tennessee, and then we finished traveling, you know, around the area together. So but yeah, I mean, they did virtual learning. I went out and did fishing, you know, met all my anglers, and we just had a great time. But at the same time, again, working, you know, I had one of my best years 2 years ago, actually in my career, doing it, and it all came literally from a camper. So, I mean, it was awesome, you know? So yeah, it was just the circumstance, you know, you just try to do what you could do the best you could through this whole COVID crap that we had to deal with.
Mm-hmm. Yep. You got to make lemonade with the lemons.
That's it, man. Exactly.
And then kind of like, what is your experience on Lake Anna and getting into this? Like, what were your thoughts? And this is why I try to ask everyone that wins, that does well on a tournament, like going into it, what was your strategy and your thoughts versus when you got there? And then what adjustments you had to make? Because usually it's the adjustments, no matter what sport it is, that makes you successful.
First of all, I hate Lake Anna. That lake is the death of me. I have never caught a limit on Lake Anna. I hate that freaking lake that saved my life. I mean, you know, I keep on telling Mike, why do you keep on going to that freaking lake? It's called the Dead Sea for a reason, man. You know? And I'll have to tell you a story, okay? So you just got to bear with me. And there's pictures and video to prove all this. Me and Jim Johnston, we went and pre-fished the middle section of the lake, right? And it's an area that, you know, I've fished before. It's okay, but I wanted to see if there's any kind of bigger fish that move kind of down mid lake after post spawn, right? I kept on seeing a lot of beds empty. Mm-hmm. So I thought for sure they're going to be kind of on secondary points, main points of the lake, you know, after post spawn in a funk. I knew they were going to be in a funk, but I just wanted to see if they're going to be in a little bit deeper water off these docks and main lake points. Well, I get to the boat ramp and, you know, I'm getting ready to put in and I pour coffee on the ground. Like I had an old coffee cup poured on the ground and I look down and this bird comes and starts hopping over to me, right? Mm. It's starling and it starts hopping over to me. It looks up at me, starts going, bah, 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 bah. I'm like, oh, what's going on? You know, little buddy. And I thought, you know, I went to reach down to pick it up and it just stayed there. Mm. And I was like, okay, you must be hungry. So let me go get some bread. I got some bread and try to feed it. It didn't touch it, right? So I put my hand out and she jumps onto my hand and then up my shoulder. Like this freaking wild bird. Like out of the blue. And so I'm holding this bird. I go up to the marina. I'm like, is this y'all's bird? You know, I'm like, is this your crazy bird? And they're like, no, like that's insane. That's crazy. So I put the bird like at the trash can, you know, at the marina. And the bird's just talking and just looking at me, just going, bah, 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 bah. And I'm like, okay. So I walk away. And, you know, and everybody, and like all the people in marina are kind of in awe about this. And then the bird like literally flies off the trash can and flies on my shoulder and would not leave. Just like she was there. And I was like, oh my God, this is crazy. So then I was like, I got to go. I got to go pre-fish. And I said, Jim, hold this bird. You know, I'm like, he's like, what is this crazy, you know? And the bird was, you know, with Jim and I launched my kayak and, you know, I'm getting ready to go. And the bird jumps off of Jim onto the dock and then onto my boat. Right on the back of my boat.
Well, shit. I mean, if you're going to be like having a Snow White moment, there's no way in hell people are going to beat your ass if you. Well, that's what I'm trying to say.
It's just meant to be things, right? Mm-hmm. So this freaking bird, this starling, like you know, I pick her up and then you know she's on my leg, and you know I'm like you, I had a Hobie at the time, so I'm trying to pedaling, you know, with the Hobie, and it was hard. So she jumped on my shoulder, and you know we're going down Duke's Creek, right? And freaking Jim is right beside me and the bird is jumping from me to Jim. I'm like, this is the damnest thing I've ever seen. I've never seen anything like this. This is crazy. And finally, you know, the bird jumps off Jim and like goes over to me and then like flies up in the trees. And we called him Frank. You know, we called this bird Frank. I'm like, all right, take care, Frank. And I'm like, Jim, what does this mean, man? This has got to be a sign. You know, it's like, we're going to destroy this freaking place, man. You know, Frank's going to take care of us, man. And so anyway, we go out there, we pre-fish. We're getting rained on. We're getting pissed on. I mean, it's raining everywhere. And we don't catch a thing. I think Jim caught like a 12-incher. And I started looking around. I'm like, man, this water's too clear. Like for me, it's too clear. I hate it. I'm not a clear water guy. And I'm not a real big reservoir, clear water, deep water guy. So I basically banked it. My buddy, Mike was pre-fishing and he's like, dude, I'm catching them cranking. Like I'm catching them deep cranking. I'm like, good for you, man. Like, you know, you get those DT-10s going, man. Good for you, dude. That's just not me. Mm-hmm. So like you, I launched at the cove and went down and I found the dirtiest, stingiest, nastiest water I could.
Did you go up or down from the cove?
I went down.
Oh, you went down. Okay. Yeah. Gotcha.
So I try to find, again, like runoff water because of the rain and just try to find just basic fishing structure, grass, you know, docks, rocks, wood, stuff like that. So I went over there and it was early morning and always at Lake Anna, I like starting with a popper. So I actually started with a spook. They were blowing up the spook. They weren't getting hooked. And so I started throwing a little 3-inch popper and caught my first fish off the popar, missed a giant. I mean, a giant came up and just annihilated it and just missed it and wouldn't bite again. And then kind of went back down, not even, I don't know, basically 45 minutes later. And I was like, well, you know, the topwater bites died, so let me just try to kind of get subsurface. So I started throwing a fluke on top of the grass and a white fluke. And it wouldn't they wouldn't touch a freaking white fluke. And I'm like, okay, well, this water's a little dingy. Let me try to give a little bit more color. So I took a highlighter and with a chartreuse pen and colored the tail. With the next three casts, I get three bass in a row. Like, boom, 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 off this grass line.
Devil's in the detail.
Yeah, exactly. So I was like, okay, sweet. And then, I missed another giant. I had another, like, you know, 18 on by the boat, and I missed, and it fell off. And I'm like, oh, my gosh. And so then I started fishing kind of like around the bank, the dock area. Well, these docks kind of go into this cove. And, you know, again, being able to fish all over the country, you kind of pick up little things. Mm-hmm. When you're dock fishing, we were fishing at Caddo, and a buddy of mine said, look, man, I'm slaying them on steps. Like, it had to be steps of these docks. Like, they weren't anywhere on the docks, but at the steps. So I found these steps off these docks. And sure enough, man, like, I skip a Cinco underneath the freaking step, and a 16 comes up and smashes it. And I'm like, oh, my gosh. And so I go into the next dock. I don't even fish all the other stuff. Go to the next dock, find the steps, boom, catch my limit. And, I mean, I'm golden for the rest of the day, right? I got, like, 74 inches or something like that. Wow. So I'm like, all right, so now it's big game hunting time. So I'm like, you know, I was like, well, I know, you know, Mike was catching them deep. So I started deep cranking. I started, you know, basically doing stuff that I haven't been doing all day just to try to get the bigger bite, you know, drop shotting and stuff. I just couldn't get another bite. But I mean, I got a limit pretty early. I think I got my limit by like 9 o'clock.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. But again, that's the first time I ever caught a limit at Lake Anna. I, as I said, it's not my favorite lake. I usually don't even fish this area. I usually go up to Christopher Run. Okay. But here just happened to work out, man. And Eddie did, by the way, Eddie did an awesome job. Me and him were kind of fighting each other all day, but Eddie kind of, you know, he got on a late bite, which I never did, and he wound up winning the tournament, man. So his first tournament win with NVKBA. So my hat's off to Eddie, man.
Yeah, huge shout out to Eddie. And guys, we will have him on. I'm talking to him right now. We're trying to work out the logistics to get him on the show, but fear not, Eddie will be on the show. Do you have, when you say deep fishing, do you have electronics on your Hobie, or are you blind casting just to generic areas for deep?
Okay. So I pre-fish with my Hobie. I actually fish, the tournament with my Old Town. I've got an Old Town, Autopilot 120. I do have electronics on that. I didn't look at electronics a single day.
Okay.
Not a single time. I'm a more of a fuel guy. So if I see like a deep ridge or a rock faced wall or whatever, I'm going to throw, you know, a crankbait off that wall and down. I was catching a lot of white perch, man. I mean, you know, doing that deep crank it off points and stuff. I'm like, man, these bass ain't here. I mean, they're inundated with white perch and stuff like that. So I'm out of here, you know? So yeah, I use it for just kind of see where I'm at in depth wise. But you know, usually you just stick to your secondary main points and stuff, kind of work around that. So
I heard people talking before the tournament about fishing that blueback bite, and I just don't know how, coming from fishing you know, Hartwell and Murray in a boat, I don't see how you run a blueback bite in a kayak unless you got that thing pimped out with a lot of electronic motors to be able to hop points. And so I didn't know if that factored in like the blueback bite at all, or you're like, nope, I don't care about that. This is just what I'm going to do.
Actually, I mean, fishing Lake Murray is a blueback herring lake. You learn a lot, and what, like, especially in the early spring, the blueback herring actually get to the back of the coves. They get pushed back there by the bass, and then you can work, like, for instance, I was pre-fishing Lake Murray, same situation, it's kind of same style creek I was fishing. All the blueback herring were pushed towards the back of the creek, but I was able to take a chatterbait through the points, through the wood, through the structure, all through that creek, and was smashing them. You know, those bass work themselves back there, you know, by point to point to point. So you don't need electronics to find that kind of bite. But if you, sometimes they'll kind of like a shad spawn, they'll like flicker, you know, on top, and then you can throw a spook or a fluke or whatever you want to into that mess. And, you know, usually the smaller fish are on top. You want to kind of get down a little bit more. So maybe like a swim jig or something like that. If you're into a blueback herring school, usually works.
Why What is your love hate with Lake Anna? What do you think the key is? Because there are big bags in there. Like, people do stick monsters. Like, what do you think makes it such an interesting place? I have my theories. I'd like to hear yours.
Well, I hate it because of the traffic. I hate it because of the boat traffic. It's like, you know, it's the summer lake for all the, you know, all the pleasure boaters, the wake boaters and stuff like that. Like, I mean, like I'm last year when we fished it, I got waked like 6 foot waves, you know, down the cove, which is ridiculous. You know, I can't stand it due to that, but also I just never have any luck. I mean, there's lakes that just have my number. I've never really had a big bass bite there. I mean, I've done okay. But nothing, it's not like a, you know, some guys have it figured out. Some guys, you know, can go to their spots and just absolutely smoke them. And I just don't have that confidence on that lake, man. Another one for me, I hate, and I just can't stand, can't seem to unlock, is Seminole, Lake Seminole down in Florida. That one just smokes me. I just can't stand it, you know? And there's other ones that I can go to and immediately just boom, you know, catch bass, no problem, you know?
Mm-hmm. No, yeah, if I had to pick one for me, it would be like the Upper Bay. Like, I've fished so many tournaments there, and for some reason, that's the one tidal place that I cannot consistently do. Yeah. And then it gets to be like it's in your head, and then you can't ever make a good decision going forward because you know you've stuck there in the past. What's going to make this any different?
Well, it's like, I mean, I don't know if you play golf, but there's some courses that fit your eye, and there's some courses that don't. You know, I mean, same with lakes. I mean, there's some that just have your number, and it's just it's unexplainable. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know. I mean, when I caught my fifth fish, dude, I was like, oh my God, I cannot believe I just caught a limit at Lake Anna. Like, this place sucks so bad. But yeah, I was like so happy, you know.
What was crazy to me was the amount of individuals that didn't catch a limit. And also, I don't know, did you see the water level? Like, I felt like the water level was still up a decent ways.
Yeah.
I wonder how much that factored into it. I really thought I screwed up launching from the cove. It's like, all right, I don't know if this part's going to be the deal. Usually down lake is where you're going to get the bigger limits. But it's interesting that it seems like a lot of the top guys actually went up. What was your thought process of why? You just wanted the off-colored water and more vegetation? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I didn't pre-fish this area. I pre-fished the area down south of this, but again, it was clearer water. Actually, I had some buddies fish not even a mile south of down where I was and didn't catch anything down there. So again, I just wanted to find runoff, you know, find a creek, find an area that had a little bit dirtier water, because I'm used to fishing like, you know, Potomac River and stuff like that. So I want to kind of, you know, associate something that's similar to I usually fish a lot. And again, I'm more of a, I wouldn't say like a super dirty water fisherman, but if it's stained, I have pretty good confidence of where those fish are going to be.
Yeah, and that's what I'm really seeing too. It's so weird, like, and this is something that I thought would hurt me when I was fishing college and stuff. Is if you're like quote unquote, if you live in this area, you're the river rat, and it's interesting to me you need to swing and play your strength, but you also need to diversify. And it's interesting. I talked to Travis Luger, who's actually doing the Bass Opens right now, and he said you got two ways. You either have to be a multi-tool and good at everything, or you got to just be damn good at one thing and make that work everywhere.
Yeah.
Is that what you do when you went across country? Is like you were just like, hey, no matter what, like I go to, I'm going to play my game? Or did you try to diversify your portfolio?
Yeah, I mean, you have to diversify, man. Like, you know, stuff that you do at St. Clair for smallies, you're not going to do down in Texas. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's various ways you have to learn how to fish. I mean, I think that's why like guys from the north can really go down south and just destroy it, because they have so much of they have a bigger tackle bag. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. They're unlike the just 3 foot lakes, the grass guy throwing top water, or, you know, throwing like a, you know, chatterbait through grass. I mean, northern guys have seen it all. They can do it all, right? You know, because they have fish every type of condition and they're able to adapt. You know, being able to travel and kind of, you know, see these various areas on how to fish what. I mean, yeah, you're not stuck on one thing. You can't throw a chatterbait when it's 20 feet water. You know what I mean? You could probably jig it up and down, but it's not going to be effective. Whereas then you have to take a crankbait or, you know, a drop shot or, you know, a Nico rig or something like that to try to get, you know, trying to get a bite, or even an Alabama rig or something like that. So, I mean, yeah, you gotta, it's all about time in the water, right? Looking at what you're seeing, you know, things that you've done in the past, what you've seen in the past and what's worked in the past will help you. Even at a new place, you know, even not even pre-fishing it, saying, wait a minute, that looks like this there. I did that then. I caught fish. Well, that should work here, you know? So yeah, I mean, that's, I'll be honest with you. Chickahominy, I fished that event with VKT, finished fourth there, and it's all like cypress trees. I love cypress trees. I fished it down at Caddo, down in Louisiana. I mean, I love cypress tree fishing. So I felt extremely confident being able to look at what these cypress trees and these structures can do. And I repeated that process when I did it out of Caddo here and did pretty well, man. So, yeah.
And then guys, for everyone that listens, if you have a question for Greg, you know, please drop a comment in the section below. We'll try to get to him before we wind up here. Kayak fishing, it was so, I guess, going from fishing tournaments, I had my thoughts of how this would play out. And then going into it, it was completely different. It's the mobility, I think, was the biggest thing for me. I mean, you can let's take tackle out of it completely. It's the idea that to run a pattern, it is a little different compared to running it on a boat. What were some things for you that was different going from a boat to a kayak or just fishing kayak tournaments that an individual that's just getting into it could help them with?
Well, like you said, I mean, the endurance you have to have. I mean, this is a sport. I mean, this is like active, you know, you have to develop Hobie legs. I mean, yes. You know, you do. I mean, you have to have stamina to do it. Like you said, you can't just blow yourself out. You have to pace yourself, right? Obviously with the modern kayak now having motors and stuff like that, it makes things easier. But like you said, I mean, there is a lot of physical endurance that you have to have and keep yourself in shape to be able to go kayak fishing, because, you know, in a boat, let's just be honest, you throw in, start the motor up, boom, and you, like you said, you can go everywhere. Also, I think it takes a lot more talent to be a kayak fisherman than a boat fisherman. And no offense to boat fishermen out there, but because you have to pick apart a place because you're stuck there. Like, you just can't like go from one side of the lake down to the other. You have to be able to go in there and decide that I'm going to fish this area and pick it apart. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And I think that patience, I'll put up a kayak fisherman in front of a bass boat fisherman any day. I mean, that might make some people upset, but hey, if you don't believe me, let's go. Like, I'll be happy to fish against you, you know? And you tell me to place spot, I'll put any kayak fisherman ahead of any bass boat guy because they know how to take that spot, pick it apart, and catch fish where they have, you know, where they're going to be. I mean, their fish are there. You just got to make them bite, you know?
Yeah, and that's something. So I had Nolan Miner on, and he fished the Hobie series, and he said when he switched from the boat to the kayak, and he has live scope too. And this was an interesting thing. He clicked. He's like, when I had live scope, I sat my kayak. I didn't realize in the lake there's always fish around you. So you might be like, well, if you don't catch them, there's clearly no fish in that area. And after he got live, he's like, no, they're still there. I just suck, and I'm not catching them. And that blew my mind. That his thought process is, generally speaking, where you launch from, there is five bass. It's up to you to figure out how to catch them. And I really was thinking about that when I fished this tournament. It's like, it's almost been a handicap having a boat, because you always think like, if I'm not catching them, I clearly got to leave, versus I just need to figure them out.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, another thing too, you can't, like, one thing with Lake Anna, I didn't have a preconceived notion of what to do. Like, I had a plan I wanted to do. Like, mm-hmm. I'm going to go deep cranking. I threw it completely out. Like, as soon as I got to the spot, I literally threw those rods that I was going to start with in the back of the boat, and I started with something. I cut my lines to like three lines, and I'm like, you know what? I'm going to completely trash my game plan and just go with this. Again, it was just instinctual, go with your gut type fishing. Sometimes you got to do that, man. I think a lot of people who don't adapt to what they see, and they want to be so hard-headed going into their game plan and even working, you know, doing what worked in pre-fishing, and you don't adapt to what your conditions you see in front of you. I'm the pre-fishing king, dude. Like, I'm the Tiger Woods of pre-fishing, man. I will destroy you pre-fishing. Come tournament day, it's a completely different story. You know what I mean? It's because I'm hard-headed. I'm hard-headed. You know, I'm like, well, this worked just yesterday. You know, well, the fish are not going to be the same. You know, they're not going to be at the same spot doing the same thing, eating the same bait at the same time than when you pre-fished. And it's taken me all this time to learn that very thing. Sometimes I scrap pre-fishing and just go fish, man. You know what I mean? It's probably the best route to do.
Pre-fishing is a freaking art. I mean, if you listen like to the Thrifts and the Polynix of the world, like two different approaches that work well. But it's like, I can never, I mean, in college, I think we used to like, oh, this one turn was at Indian Lake in Ohio. We pre-fished, we put 3 weeks on there. And then I've done that before, and then we've bombed completely. So yeah. It's so weird about like when you actually listen to the clues and when you have to freaking ignore them. And it's almost like if you have too much data in your head, it actually messes you up compared to where if you just walk out of bed and you just go for it.
I think you have to trust yourself and have enough confidence in yourself. And you know what to do at what specific time. No one has to tell you what to do. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You have that gut feeling. Go with your gut, man. 9 times out of 10, you'll do much better.
Yeah. Now, amen to that. So one thing just want to go over again real quick is what bait should you catch them on? Just for the people just tuned in.
Yeah, man. So I caught them on. Okay. So the first bait I was a popar, a three inch popar. And then a fluke and so it was a white fluke again, using that chartreuse tail, caught one on a chatterbait, and I caught a ton of smaller fish on Senkos, on a green pumpkin with red watermelon flake Senko in structure. I thought I had a giant on. Oh my gosh. I thought I had this giant upgrade. I was like, Eddie, you're going down, brother. I started freaking cranking this thing, and believe it or not, man, it was a 13 inch bass that fought like freaking Mike Tyson underneath this log, wrapped it around me, man. And I pulled this thing out of this log, and it was 13 inches. I'm like,
dagger. Dude,
like, what? Like, how is this possible, man? It was crazy. But anyway, yeah. Anyway, it was okay.
I caught a bunch of dinks. I was surprised. I haven't caught this many dinks before at Lake Anna before. Usually it's like feast or famine, at least for my history it's been, but I don't know what it was, but I did catch a lot of dinks as well. Why? So what's with the two kayak setup? Is that just, you like to do pre-fishing in the Hobie and then go to the trolling motor then during the tournament, or?
You know, it's interesting, man. The two kayak setup is this, because I like to fish very shallow grassy areas in my outback with the Hobie, because I can get into very skinny water really well. If I'm fishing pretty big water, like reservoirs or something, and I'm going longer areas, I'm going to use my
Okay. Oop, he hit something. So while he gets his audio fixed up there, because it shows me that he's muted, somehow disconnected his mic there. We might have to use American Sign Language. Their mic isn't connected. So yeah, it says their mic isn't connected. But while he gets that fixed up, I can actually talk about what I did, because everyone cares about what I did, finishing, you know, in 31st place. Still can't hear him. Let's try to get it right here. Still can't hear you there, Greg. Nothing. No guapo. You might want to, you could also just log on and log back on and see if that actually does it. Yeah, but guys, please, if you have a question for Greg while he has it, no guapo there. While he gets his mic fixed, guys, please like drop a comment real quick about if you have any questions for Greg. This would be a good time to kind of talk about, you know, my finish. I didn't actually get started fishing. I didn't really start fishing until about 10:30 at the tournament. Because I was really frazzled, like trying to figure out this whole kayak deal. So about 10:30, I actually got settled in and actually started fishing. I had a couple bites on a popper, believe it or not, too. I was using the Rizuri cover pop, using that one. But then I got onto a bluegill deal as well.
How about now?
Perfection, sir. It's crazy. Yeah, technology. Oh my God. I feel it.
It's the gremlins, man.
Oh my God. It always happens also when you don't, like, the worst timing.
Exactly, man. So, but yeah, I mean, we were talking about boats. The reason why is because, again, bigger water boats, you know, the Old Town 120 does an amazing job in like real, like big water, like Lake Anna, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. If you're going to be going across and fishing kind of like main lake reservoirs, stuff like that, you're going to cover a lot of water. I love the Old Town, but if I'm in real skinny water, grassy areas, you know, I'm not going to go that far, then I'll use a Hobie.
Okay. So then I guess going for this next tournament coming up, are you going to be going more Hobie then?
Okay. So the next tournament is what, the Bronzeback deal?
Yeah. I think we got Rappahannock, Upper Potomac, Shenandoah River.
Yeah. Rocky, so that's shallow. June 18th, I think, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to be fishing KFL for the Warhawks that day. So we've got Carolina coming in and Norfolk coming in to town. So we're going to be at Hunting Run.
That's a great segue to start talking about that organization too. Like, yeah, just the floor is yours. Like, talked about that.
Oh man, the KFL is fantastic. I mean, it's, you know, it's kind of like the NFL of kayak fishing, man. I mean, we've got 28 teams across the country from Maine to Texas. You know, and our local team is the Washington Warhawks. We've got 8 awesome guys on our team. Wow. Our guys are all NVKBA guys. It's Jim Johnson, myself, Will Brewer, Dustin Good, Joel, Mike Hogan, and Victor Hendricks, and Joe Costa. So all 8 of us, man, we have a good time. Our chat is ridiculous. It's so much fun. And we're sponsored by Beer Works Brewery out of Woodbridge. They do an awesome job with us. And yeah, we got Michigan coming in come June 4th. They're going to be coming here, fishing the Potomac River. They're 4 guys versus our 4 guys. It's going to be broadcasted on everything, Motion Sports and KFL Network. And you can download the KFL app. Check us out. Go to Washington Warhawks, our social media sites. See what's going on, man. But man, we're excited. Can't wait to get the season get started. Last year we were 2-4, had a pretty rough season, man, but I think we got it together this year. We're gonna make some noise.
How does it work for the people like me that like this team thing? Is it just the most inches per team, or is it the best 5? Or
it's the 10 best fish inches wise. So it's your 10 best as a team for 4 anglers, and it runs like it's a scoreboard, man. It runs just like a basketball or baseball scores or whatever. I mean, it's us versus them, and there's 6 hours or 7 hours to fish. Okay. Our lines are at 6 o'clock through 1 o'clock, or there's evening games from 12 to 7.
Huh.
Yeah. And then again, you have a clock, you have a scoreboard, you have, a record, and you have, we have division. We're in the Atlantic. I'm sorry. We're in the Piedmont division, which is us, Virginia Reapers, Norfolk Privateers, Carolina Casters, and Tar Heel Lunkers. So
shit, banging names, my guy's like minor league baseball. I love it.
Oh, exactly. That's exactly what it's like. It's like a minor league baseball league, right? So yeah, I mean, and everybody has their uniforms. They have jerseys. They have numbers in the back. They have their names in the back. They have sponsors, and all that stuff, man. It's freaking amazing, dude.
How do people, if they want to eventually, like, do you try out for this? Do you sign up? How does that all work?
Yeah, I mean, you have to kind of, you have to be a hammer, man. I mean, like, we're not just picking, our purpose is we want to win, man.
So it's
an
invite. Gotcha.
Yeah, you have, I mean, if you're wanting to try out and see what you are, I mean, Will Brewer's the owner of the Warhawks, then him and Jim Johnson. So, you got to talk to them. I mean, about next year and see what happens, man. I mean, players come and go, on these squads. But yeah, we started out with 17 teams last year. We have 28 teams this year. Well, our max is going to be 32. We think we already have the 32 teams lined up for next year. So, man, it's awesome, dude. It's just like the NFL. It works just like it.
That's really
cool. You have a regular season. There's 8 games. You have playoffs, and then you have a championship.
Wow, guys. And then a link in the episode description when this gets re-uploaded to all this information as well, just so you can check this out, because this is like really cool. And you said it's like live stream, so each person has a GoPro. That's got to be an ordeal.
They use their cell phones.
Yeah. Oh, these are cell phones. Okay,
we use StreamYard.
Oh, so, okay, cool.
Yeah. So we do exactly what you're doing. We have broadcasters that are broadcasting all the content. Every game is going to be shown, kind of like NFL Red Zone, right? Every game has its own channel. So you can go to YouTube and look at all the games on KFL's YouTube, and then you'll be able to see, you can click and choose whatever game that you want to. You can go to the KFL app, and it'll have all the games live there. And then we'll have a main broadcast, a main KFL broadcast. Jim Johnston and Randy Newton are taking care of week 1 for us. They're going to come in, show the scoreboards, kind of go into the game and see what's going on. And then we'll have anglers on during the broadcast as well. So yeah, man, freaking awesome.
That is really freaking cool. And yeah. Like, how many years has this been going on?
This is our second year.
Second year?
Mm-hmm.
This thing's going to blow up. I mean, this is like MLS local. Like that That's brilliant. And using StreamYard like that with people's phones, that is just a brilliant way to kind of, in a cheap way, to actually get around the whole logistics. Just because, I mean, again, like tech could get real expensive real freaking quick.
Oh, so expensive. Yeah. I mean, so they've been charged to make sure you have good cell phone service and batteries and all that stuff. So, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's freaking awesome. Greg, is there anything else that, anything you want to talk about with your businesses or sponsors that we haven't touched on yet?
I do want to say a shout out to Three Bells Outdoors and Outfitters. Three Bells, it's Three Bells, BELLES Outfitters. they are the main sponsor for the presenting sponsor for the KFL. Give them a shout out. If you need anything kayak stuff, man, give them a shout. Obviously, Jake's Bait and Tackle here locally, man. Mm-hmm. Take care of them, you know, with all your tackle needs. And Rippert Energy, man, I want to say thank you for them sponsoring the KFL as well. So yeah, man. I mean, and then obviously Beer Works Brewery here locally, Woodbridge. Go see them. Awesome guys over there, man. Hey, come out, hang out with us after the game. We plan on going up there and having a great time and you know, joining in the fun and hopefully celebrate a victory for the Washington Warhawks after June 4th, man. So we're excited for that.
Well, yeah, good luck. I know that's coming real quick. And yeah, best of luck to you guys. I'll definitely be rooting for you. And again, yeah, give him a follow, guys. Give this kayak organization a follow as well. This is really cool stuff just to get more content out there and to be able to watch more tournament fishing. Because I know I'm completely addicted when the Bassmasters come on. Now that I know about this, this will be something else that I'll be definitely addicted to as well.
Right on.
Greg, thanks again for coming on.
Hey, dude. Bro. Thank you, man. Appreciate it. Enjoyed it.
Yep, you're welcome. Thank you.
Take care.
So guys, there you have it. Greg, second place finish. Banker, you know, entrepreneur, love it all. Please let me know in the comment section what other content you'd like me to bring on the channel. Other kind of people. Do you want me to do more tournaments? You want me to do more guides? You want me to bring more like government officials on that talks about the nature? I like to just sprinkle a little bit of everything on the show. And again, if you guys are just tuning in, I know based on all the polls I've done, people are like, when's the Hidden Gem series coming back? When's the Hidden Gem series coming back? The Hidden Gem series is coming back. I got my MBA. I just finished it up. I have technically one last class I have to take this summer, but I got the diploma. I got to walk. So my MBA is now pretty much done. So the Hidden Gem series is coming back this summer. I want to try to launch one Hidden Gem episode per month. That way I have enough time to shoot and edit a high quality video that also has a lot of information about where I'm fishing. I don't want this to be about me catching fish because no one really cares if I catch fish. I really just want to highlight different fisheries that people haven't thought about. So that is going to be coming back. So stay tuned for that as well. Next week, we are only going to have one episode drop because of the Memorial Day weekend. I want to make sure every individual that we've had on the show has time to shine. And just with Memorial Day weekend, I don't want that to overshine our guests. So I will definitely be dropping one, I think, on Wednesday next week, and then that's it. And then we'll get back to our normal rotation the following week as well. We got Lee Wells with a question here. I'm definitely going to be covering the NVKBA. I'm going to try to get every winner of every tournament on, and then whoever else wants to come on the show as well. I want to try to cover every local event, whether it's NVKBA or any local bass tournament we had last week. If you guys want to check out that episode, we had the local high school guys that actually qualified for the national championship. We're really trying to be like the local radio show for the greater DMV area that covers everything outdoor sports fishing related specifically right now. But again, if you guys have an idea, I go through the comment section always. I check emails that people get me. If you have an idea for a guest, I don't care who it is. We'll have him on because I love the stories. That's the biggest thing with Greg. It was just interesting to find out like how he got into social media. I think that's fascinating. And so it's not just about the fishing. It's about the story around the individual. But yeah, like that was freaking awesome. Any other questions people have for me in the comment section before I log off here? Oh, big news. So I just got the paperwork back. Fishing the DMV is now a LLC. We just got the paperwork back. We signed it. We have a bank account. I am now officially an LLC. So this is actually an official business type thing. So we have huge plans for the rest of 2022 and 2023. And hopefully, you know, someday maybe this will become my full-time job and we can actually grow out more employees, more content creators, and really make this something for the... I'm super excited. I really am. This is the first announcement. I haven't posted anything about it. More posts to come. But yeah, as of today, Fishing the DMV is an LLC, and I'm really hoping this is more cool things to come. The last thing, we're also going to ICAST this year. We are going down to ICAST with Jake's Bait and Tackle. So we're going to be specifically bringing content back for this area. So unlike just showing you like, okay, there's a cool duck bait that costs $1,000 and weighs about 3 pounds and you need a shark rod to throw it, we're going to go down to ICAST and specifically look for stuff that would help anglers catch fish in our area, that fish the rivers, that fish the tidal Potomac. Kayak guys, same thing. So if you guys have something specific you want us to look at, please let me know in the comment section. More information about ICAST to come. And again, if you want to see something in particular, let me know. And I'll put out some polls and some different posts to try to get some good fan interaction beforehand. But not only are we an LLC, we're going to ICAST 2022 down in Florida. So I'm really pumped about that as well. Any more information, please feel free to email me at aaronsbassin@gmail.com or just message me on Facebook. I don't care. I like to talk to people. Anyways, works. Until next time on Fishing the DMV. Bye, guys.
You're listening to Fishing the DMV with your hosts, Thomas Aarons and Jared Mounts. Fishing the DMV is brought to you by Jake's Bait and Tackle, located in Winchester, Virginia.
If that doesn't get you jacked up, I don't know what will.